Drones are the essential tools on the modern battlefield, but there's a huge amount of overlap between civilian drone technology and military drone technology. So every time you see a drone light show from China, it's an implicit show of military force. And while these displays are super impressive, they're basically flying open loop, pre-scripted paths entirely reliant on GPS. To be useful in an actual operational context, the drone needs to be able to sense and respond to the environment around it while taking direction from a human operator. AI and autonomy are the essential enabling technologies. I'm here with a bunch of X10D systems. This is a real fielded drone in the hands of the US and allied militaries around the world, and it was built around AI and autonomy. These play to our strengths as a country. Today, we're taking the next step. We're gonna see if we can fly these things autonomously through the forest with collaborative autonomy. So let's go ahead and launch the drones. And let's see what they can do. Before we get to the demo, today we're announcing an incredibly important software update that we're in the midst of rolling out to all of our defense customers. We've spent a lot of time in Ukraine over the last couple of years, and we've learned a bunch of really hard lessons about what it takes to make these systems useful in an actual operational context. The dominant feature of the modern battlefield is electronic warfare, communication jamming, and GPS jamming. And in order to be useful, a drone needs to be resilient to both of these. We also continue to invest in making X10 an open modular platform, and I'll share more about that as well. The foundation for any kind of advanced drone operation is an onboard navigation solution. The drone needs to know where it is and how it's moving. Traditionally, most drones rely on GPS for this. And if they lose GPS, they won't be able to perform any autonomous operations, and they'll require constant expert pilot input to remain stable. Now, Skydio drones have always been vision native, but historically, we've focused on using vision at low altitudes because once you're at high altitudes, GPS is usually more reliable. On the battlefield, that's not the case. So over the last year, our teams have done incredible work to extend our visual navigation system to now work up to 1,000 feet. What this means for the operator is that you get super easy, stable manual flight, even up to 1,000 feet. And it also means that the drone can autonomously find its way home if it needs to without needing GPS. Over a multi-kilometer flight, we've demonstrated the drone coming back within a few tens of meters of its original takeoff location. VIO is a relative positioning system. It tracks the relative motion of the drone over time. But there's a lot of times where you want to know where the drone is in an absolute coordinate frame. You want to be able to plot waypoints on a map. You want to be able to measure the altitude or the precise position of what you're looking at to relay coordinates. So for that, we've developed anchor point navigation. What this does is it allows the operator, using any map, to specify where the drone is and where it's pointing, and then it'll use VIO to track its relative motion with a very low drift rate, typically less than 1%. What this means is that all the features that typically need GPS, waypoints, crosshair coordinates, setting a different return location, all these things are now unlocked, even with no GPS. You can set the anchor point at takeoff or at any point during the flight. You can also update it as many times as you need to if you see new reference points. The beauty of anchor point is that you can really use any map. It doesn't have to be especially high fidelity. It can come from any source. You just need to be able to say where the drone is relative to the map that you have. One of our core tenets of designing software at Skydio is that we want to automate as much as possible, but we also want to give the user the ability to take fine-grained control when they need it. So with all these different navigation modes, the drone will automatically select what it thinks is best based on the conditions, strength of GPS, health of visual navigation system, and so on. But we've also given the option for full manual control. So you can toggle between GPS, visual inertial odometry, or you can turn it all off and fly in attitude mode where you've got raw stick control to the attitude of the drone. Now, the thing that drives the majority of the drone attrition in Ukraine is the combination of GPS jamming and communication jamming. Now, in this scenario, the drone typically just flies off and they lose it. We've taken a huge bite out of this with a way more robust visual navigation solution. But sometimes everything is still going to fall apart. if vision fails and comms are jammed, we've developed something we're calling heading return mode. This works by always remembering the heading to return home, or the operator can manually set a heading. And if navigation and comms are lost, X10D will automatically fly in that direction. Usually, this will enable it to exit the jamming area for the operator to recover control. But if not, it dramatically increases the chances of it landing in a friendly area. With the robust visual navigation we just talked about, X10D is way less reliant on communications than anything else out there. But you still need real-time comms to get the live video back from the drone and to redirect it as needed. With this Asimov software release, we've made huge steps forward in the link for the drone on the battlefield. The first critical piece of this is dramatically improved dynamic channel switching. With DCS, the drone will automatically keep switching frequencies if it encounters jamming, and it'll keep going until it finds an open channel. We've also tripled the video throughput rate that's on by default, which means you get higher resolution with more detail at longer range. We also continue to invest in X10D's modular open system architecture so that you can extend it to meet the mission need. You can fly X10D from third-party controllers and with third-party software, like ATAC UAS tool or QGC. We make it as easy as possible to get the video and data that the drone is generating into your common operating picture. So you can stream everything out over RTSP, and we're also adding KLV telemetry so that you can get precise coordinates for everything the drone is seeing. All of this information can be seamlessly pushed out over your TAC network, which means that everybody on that network has exactly the same information you do for a complete, holistic, common operating picture. Now, if you're flying with the Skydio controller, you can actually even switch between flying on the Skydio app, flying with QGC, or flying with the ATAC UAS tool, depending on the need of the mission. Modularity isn't purely a software story. It extends to hardware as well. And with our new Interface Control Document, or ICD, we're making it very easy for third parties to develop their own payloads. These range from new communication paradigms, new electronic warfare collection methodologies, different actuation schemes. All of it's now possible on X10D. Our goal is to make X10D the most useful small UAS ISR platform on the planet. And with this Asimov software release, we've taken a huge step forward. We're already getting incredibly positive feedback from users deploying these features in real operational scenarios. And all of this work is building towards a world where one operator can seamlessly control many drones. So let's get back to the forest to check out those X10Ds using collaborative autonomy. All right, so we're back. We got a bunch of drones in the air. Now, the software we're looking at here is not shipping in our latest release, but is not too far away either.
The mission here is to search the forest in coordination with each other to ensure full coverage of all the land space while avoiding all obstacles, including other drones.
So you can tell us a little bit about how this is working, Kyle?
Yeah, sure. So there's an agent running that's connected to each platform, and those platforms are being controlled via the RAS-A Mavlink ecosystem. The agents then are leveraging the autonomy that's on board each individual aircraft to make sure that they're not hitting any of the trees, but they're also communicating with each other, and those agents are keeping the platforms from colliding with each other.
And so they're using their onboard cameras to see what's happening around them in the forest and figure out where they should go and how to avoid obstacles. Yeah. Sweet.